So now we've learned a little bit about object orientation in general. Now we're going to actually look at the syntax to build our own object. Now my goal in showing you all this is not necessarily so that you're going to write a whole bunch of objects. I just want to see enough of it to help cement the definitions of methods and attributes, classes, objects, and instances. So we'll start by taking a look at how you might solve a problem, a data structures problem, without using object orientation. And this is, you know, in PHP for years, we could avoid object-oriented programming and complex data structures by just using arrays in super clever ways. And so let's just imagine what we're doing is we're creating a data structure about people. And they might have a full name or a given name and a family name. And so here we're going to have two variables of two people. And so the first one has a full name and an office. And the second variable, Colleen, has a family name, given name, and a room. And so we're allowing some variation within this structure because different people have different things. And so we want to write a function called get the person's name and take one of these as parameters. And what we basically look for is if there is a full name in there, that's what we're looking for. And if there's a family name and a given name, we're going to concatenate those two things together with a space. So this is just a bit of code so that we can tolerate different structures in these arrays. And it's a really simple example. And so we're going to say, what is get Chuck's person name? And that gives me the full name, Chuck Severance, pulling this out here. And then get me the person name for Colleen. Well, Colleen is different, but it still concatenates those two things together and gives me a blank. And so we don't have to worry in our main code what format these two things are in because we're sort of compensating for that. And this is one of the things that objects allow us to do is sort of capture things and just call a function to take care of the work. And so we don't have to write if statements or anything like that. Otherwise, we'd be putting if statements down here, yada, yada, and be four or five lines of code every time we want to do it. So we put it in a function and reuse that. Of course, this is a pretty silly one. So let's just look at how we might do that in an object. And this introduces the notion of attributes. So we are making a new class. So if you take a look at the new class, we have a new keyword called class that's like the word function, except we're telling it we're beginning a new class. And so we're going to create a class called person, open curly brace, and then we can have some variables in here. And we'll talk more about the public stuff. What public means is this variable can be accessed by code that's outside the class, not just inside the class. So we're going to have a full name, a given name. Now you'll notice these are not strings. We're not really making an array here. We're making an object. And so full name, given name, and family name, and then room. And then we're going to add a function, and we name it differently. This is going to be a get name within person, right? And so we don't have to have the functions quite as long. And we're not even going to put any parameters in because the data is already part of this object. And so the this variable, $this, is a special variable. You don't have to define it. It actually points to the current instance of the object, and it'll make more sense a little bit lower. So getName looks up checks to see if the full name is not false and returns it. If the family name and the given name are not false, it concatenates those two things together and returns that with a space, and away we go. Same kind of basic logic, but the big deal is the this, and that's to look at these variables, but they're not class variables, they're instance variables. And this points to the current instance. Okay? Points to the current instance. So now, if we come down here and say, let's make a new person. So this new is the construction. Take the person template, make a thing that's shaped like this. It's shaped like all this. Make one and stick it in the variable Chuck. And here's a new little operator. Chuck arrow full name is changing, so now there's a Chuck variable out here, and there is a full name inside here, and we're putting something in that full name, and we're putting something in the room, putting something inside that. Now what we're going to do is make another object from the class slash template. Make Colleen equals new person, so that means let's make a new Colleen variable, and it has all these same things in it, has all the methods in it, and we're going to put the family name in and the given name in and then the room in. So now at this point in the code, we've got two variables, two objects, two instances, one class. And now we can say, let's get the name from the Colleen variable and then let's get the name from the Chuck variable. And it does all that same thing. And so if we look at what's going on right here, this runs this code, getName runs. And at this point in time, this is equal to Chuck. So Chuck is out here, and Colleen is out here. This points to the current one that we're using. It's this one here. Okay, so we're calling getName within Chuck. While that getName is running, this points to Chuck. A moment later, we're calling getName within Colleen. And when that code runs, this points to Colleen. Okay, so this is sort of like whichever the current instance or object, instance and object are the same thing, class is the template, instance and object are the same thing. Okay, and so that is kind of like how the object-oriented stuff works. And we'll kind of hit this a little bit more, but you get the basic idea of the arrow operator, the new operator, and the concept of this. $this is a variable that is only defined within a method inside of a class. That's why methods and functions are different. So let's also, now that we've sort of know some of these new ideas and we've seen our own class, let's take a look at some of the kind of things that will happen as you're reading PHP documentation. So we've already talked about the little arrow operator that basically says go find the method or attribute within this particular instance. But there's also a way to access things inside the class, and that's the double colon operator, colon, colon. Okay, and so these two things are important, and so let's take a look at some documentation. So if we look at this date time again, we see some constants. And so these are constants that are given to us by the class. And so there's Adam, they're namespaced. That's, to me, 80% of the fun of this is namespacing. So we can name something whatever makes sense, a cookie formatted date. The word cookie has all kinds of meaning in HTML and HTTP and all these other things, right? But we can use cookie, datetime, colon, colon, cookie. These are class-wide constants. They're not methods, and so this is the class name, not an instance name. This is, go look something up in the class, and that's the thing we're looking up, and so that grabs this RFC 822 bit, which is really just a predefined string that pulls that stuff out. So double colon accesses class-wide things, things that are part of the template, not part of the instance slash object. Then another thing that we look at is you look at there's a couple of methods that have special names. And so the first one we'll look at is the one that's underscore underscore construct. That basically says is when PHP is going to construct a new date time, call this function. And we'll see how to do that in a bit. So it's the new operator that goes to construct. Now when you're reading documentation, it just means that you can read all the parameters that you're allowed to have. And you can see, oh, I could do a date time, I can have a string, I can do this, I can do a date time for a particular date. And you can go read this documentation for the construct method, and it tells you what you're allowed to put in the parentheses when you're making a new object from the class template. Okay, so underscore underscore construct documents how the new operator functions. Don't know why they didn't call that underscore underscore new. That's a good question to ask. Another thing to look at as you look at documentation is the notion of static. And static is a way that you can mark something as, in a sense, belonging to the class, but not to the instances. Well, actually, it also belongs to the instances as well. And so, let me clear this. When you see static, that kind of is in the way there. When you see static, you get a... You can call this function, this getLastErrors function, you can call it with the class name. So datetime colon colon getLastErrors. And so this is a way of creating global library code that can be run from the class, but we're taking advantage of the namespacing of the class. And so it's common to have a number of things called getLastErrors, but that's getLastErrors within the datetime class. Now the key difference when you're writing a class, which we're not going to write too many of them, is you can't use $this in static code because it's running without an instance existing, and so that you can just run it. And there's also static variables that you can put into a class. So the simple thing from reading documentation is when you see that word static, you expect that you're going to call it this way with the name of the class, colon, colon, then the method name, rather than, you know, dollar X arrow method name. So, you know, another thing, here's a normal method. It's not a static method, and so we're going to access this method using the arrow. So we make a new date time in the variable z, and then we access the format method. And you can see the parameters that you're allowed to put by reading the documentation that has those things. And so you go in PHP document, click on that, and then you'll go be able to read what are the kind of things that you can pass in as parameters to this function. There are some really cool things. Most of what I just talked about, the concept of static and methods and class-wide static code, that's common across most OO languages. We'll see that over and over again. There are a few little weird things that are really quite cool in PHP, having to do with object lifecycle in web applications. And so PHP's object orientation, PHP was one of the last languages to become object-oriented, and by the time it became object-oriented in PHP 5, it was already a widely used and heavily used and well-understood language, and so there's some really cool features. I won't go into them, but anytime you see one of these __ methods, it's usually sort of part of the bookkeeping of objects themselves. So up next, we'll talk a little bit about object lifecycle.